Starting in the early 1960s, American K-12 education was transformed from focusing on facts and knowledge to using techniques from behavioral psychology, Pavlov and B.F. Skinner, to socialize students. So-called new math was introduced, leading to criticism by top mathematicians, parents, and many educators, and phonics was replaced by whole word reading instruction. These changes resulted in a decade-long decline in standardized test scores, from which we have never recovered. The 1973 book, Why Johnny Can't Read, and the 1983 groundbreaking report by the federal government, A Nation at Risk, kicked off initiatives at every level of government to try to fix education. Federal spending and involvement in education continued to rise, kept by the 2001 No Child Left Behind Act. This act required the states to develop high-stakes tests for their students and imposed ratings and punishments for schools that did not keep up. Teachers and parents bitterly complained that these high-stakes tests resulted in teachers teaching to the test. After the 2007-2008 financial crash, $50 billion in federal stimulus funds were used to push states to implement detailed databases to track and analyze our children.
There's a student enrollment information on graduates, transfers, and dropouts, state assessment scores, information on students not tested. Perhaps your children are homeschooled. Perhaps they go to a private school. Finance records and health records are included in the data system. Now, how many kindergartners do you think have financial records?
And later, Race to the Top funding was used to convince 45 of 50 states to implement the new Common Core state standards. Common Core has been implemented virtually in secret, yet parents, legislators, and many teachers have risen up to oppose Common Core. Both the New York State and Chicago Teachers Unions have voted against Common Core. Join Anne Marie Banfield, Education Liaison of Cornerstone in New Hampshire, as she leads our five-session series with Jamie Gass, Director of School Reform at the Pioneer Institute, Dr. Sandra Stotsky, Professor Emerita at the University of Arkansas, Sid Glasner, Senior Fellow at the New England Institute for the Study of Education, and Dr. James Milgram, Professor Emeritus in Mathematics at Stanford University.
So let's jump into the English Language Arts Standards. And if we refer to them as ELAs, that's what we mean, English Language Arts Standards. So today I think what we're going to do is we're going to jump right to Jamie. He's from Pioneer Institute, and he's going to kind of explain the research behind the Common Core English Standards and what Pioneer has done to actually look at these standards, and then we'll get into what are the problems with them and why are they not good for our school. So Jamie, can you kind of give us an overview of that?
Sure. So I work for Pioneer Institute. It's an independent, nonpartisan think tank in Massachusetts. Massachusetts has been very fortunate over the last 20 years or so. We had historic education reforms that were undertaken. A key element of it was the high academic standards, particularly in English language arts and mathematics. That really catapulted Massachusetts from about middle of the pack in terms of SAT to number one in the country and internationally competitive. The key ingredient of the English language arts standards that Dr. Stotsky developed was a deep commitment to classic literature, poetry, and drama. And the reason why this matters is that the quality of the vocabulary found in those kinds of texts is just significantly better than the informational texts or nonfiction that Common Core offers. So given that Massachusetts was number one and that the Common Core advocates really needed to have Massachusetts adopt Common Core in order to have the other states fall into line, we decided to conduct four independent, peer-reviewed analysis of Common Core's drafts against high standard states like Massachusetts and California and Indiana and others. And what Dr. Stotsky found was that Common Core was of significantly lower quality than all the high performing, high standard states, and it specifically cut classic literature, poetry, and drama dramatically. Since that collection of evaluations that were done in 2010. We have done two other papers with Dr. Stotsky and Mark Bauerlein, who's a literature professor from Emory, and then another one just recently in the last couple weeks on poetry and the loss of poetry. So you're in for a real treat, because Dr. Stotsky really is the only academic expert on standards who can claim to have her standards have correlated with historic gains on national and international tests. But that gives you a sort of the groundwork and understanding basis for why we were concerned about Massachusetts adopting Common Core.
Right, and so you guys have the proof. One of the biggest arguments against Common Core is, where's the proof? Where are the studies that show that this works? And in Massachusetts, we have that. We have that because the students were performing highest in the country. We knew that they were the best standards in the country. So, of course, the kids seem to follow the standards. They're going to do the best. It seems like we had the example there, and now we're ending up with Common Core. You were a member of the validation committee. You refused to sign off. Why? What was wrong with the standards, the Common Core standards, from your perspective, especially compared to the person that they chose? They knew your credentials. They knew that you were the expert, and yet you couldn't sign off. You had done the work in Massachusetts. What did you see? What were the problems with the standards? Because I think that's what parents really want to know. What are the problems?
There are a number of major flaws, and you can see the good examples because all of the good standards have similar features. California, Indiana, Massachusetts, for example, they all have an organizational outline that gives primacy to literary study by the secondary grades. That's one major virtue of the better standards, because that is what English teachers are trained to teach, and that is where students learn how to do analytical reading and writing by studying complex literary texts by high school. Another flaw, and you do not see this particular flaw in those documents, Common Core's emphasis on more writing than reading. We know from 100 years of reading research that all good writers were good readers. Reading should take primacy in K-12. Most teachers understand that students should be doing more reading than writing. Yes, you would have to do some writing in order to be a writer, but you learn how to write good English sentences by having seen them over and over again. And unfortunately, Common Core has emphasized writing over reading in terms of the number of standards and substandards that it requires teachers to pay attention to. It has even turned mathematics itself into a semi-language arts because it requires students to spend a good part of their time in a mathematics class also doing writing. No one is saying that students shouldn't learn how to write explanations. The question is, what is the proper role of the time allotted for the study of mathematics, and how much writing should we expect in any subject when students need to do a lot more reading? Now, a third flaw, which I've kind of mentioned, is the reduction of literary study in Common Core, and the introduction and emphasis on more informational text or nonfiction text. That has been justified in a peculiar way by the writers of Common Core's ELA standards. They have said that since in real life we do more reading of expository prose or informational prose, and since college work requires the reading of more informational textbooks than literary works, therefore, and that's the key problem, there is no therefore, they say, the English teacher should use half of his or her time in K-12 teaching informational texts and how to read them and how to write them. That is not where students, as I say, learn how to read their textbooks in other subjects. That comes about by what happens in other subjects. And that is the proper role of what these other teachers should be doing, but it shouldn't be half of the English class time. Then there is the problem of standards that we have a claim for, that they are clearer, fewer, and deeper. This is a misclaim, because Common Core standards in both math and English language arts are not actually fewer. What they've done is bundle lots of activities and objectives into one statement, separate the various pieces by colons and semicolons. It's a trick that everyone knows how to do when you've got extra stuff that you want to get taught. And you find that you end up with incomprehensible sentences as standards. And you can read almost any Common Core statement and find too many parts to it, which is why teachers are told to unpack the standards when they first have workshops on these standards. In other words, they don't explain themselves. They're not clear statements of some body of knowledge and intellectual objective students should aim for. They are too many bits and pieces of activities and objectives together. So you have a lot of basic flaws. Developmental progressions aren't there. You have one standard paraphrased in umpteen different ways through the grades. There are missing standards, which is why you don't have the rigor at the high school level. And I had a large group of literary scholars at a meeting in Bloomington, Indiana, at the beginning of April, look at Common Core standards and just tell me what they would suggest to strengthen them. I was trying to be diplomatic. And they came up with any number of standards that they thought were missing and should be there. For example, there should be the study of writers before Shakespeare and after Shakespeare, because Shakespeare is mentioned exactly once in the document, and he is the only British writer mentioned at all in Common Core's standards. But there are more details I could go into, but that sort of gives you an overview.
Wow, okay. Yeah, I think that's, you know, I'm hearing again with these standards that they're developmentally inappropriate. And so I think to have that translated, from a math perspective, when you see a child crying at the table because they can't do the math problem, I think it becomes obvious, you know, when the parents can't have trouble figuring out the math problem. But so is that what you're hearing, Sid? I mean, you were a teacher, you were an administrator, and I always like to go to your perspective because you were in the classroom. You've seen quality materials. I'm sure that you've probably seen, you know, bad materials in the classroom. What is going to happen using these standards that we know were not approved of by the leading experts in the country? What's going to happen when we start using them, when the teachers are forced to use these?
Well, we're in a lot of trouble, for one thing. I'm going to ride on Sandra's a few things she said in a little different way. But when I was a principal, I could walk into any school actually, and I can tell what the writing program was depending upon what the reading program was. So I'll hitch on to what Sandra said. If you're not going to have a reading program that is immersed to a great degree in literature and poetry, you're not going to be able to have a decent writing program. It just doesn't work, and it's not going to happen. Because we learn to write by reading. And with the danger here with the Common Core is that they have minimized, as Sandra said, the literary experience of kids. And that is very dangerous. Not only dangerous in terms of who they become as human beings, in terms of the humanities approach to literature, but it also endangers our way of life and our way of government. Because if we keep developing people who are not going to be readers, we're not going to have our democracy, or we're not going to continue to evolve our democracy. So we have a very, very dangerous situation here. And I would hate to see what this is going to look like in another generation if we keep these Common Core things the way they are. So that's a major problem. And I don't know what else I can say except that we're in trouble like this.
Yeah.
And we cannot, you know, we're minimizing literature, and that's very dangerous.
Yeah, that's that. Okay, so Jamie, back to you. you know, I hear from the proponents of Common Core, hey, we can throw these books and we can use these books if they're not on the list. First of all, kind of go through the books that are on the list and maybe the books that are not on the list, because, you know, what we'll hear a lot of times is they're just a set of standards. Not necessarily. They're delving into pedagogy, the teaching method. They're giving us a list of texts or books that they recommend. What are the problems with the books that they recommend, and what are the problems with the books that they don't recommend? And can they really use books that maybe they don't recommend? Because the proponents are saying, hey, you know what, if a teacher wants to use a book that's not on the list, they can. So what's your thought?
So the first thing is that states had to adopt Common Core 85% word for word and are allowed to add about 15% additional to that. The problem is that the point of national standards is uniformity. So whatever 15% Massachusetts or Mississippi puts onto these standards will not be on the uniform national test that they share in common. This is just common sense, I think. So Common Core does have a list of exemplar texts. There's some things on there that I think all of us would agree are fine. Gettysburg Address, Letter from Birmingham Jail by MLK. What they recommend that you do, in fact, the lead author has said that you're supposed to forget all of the historical context for Letter from Birmingham Jail or Gettysburg Address. And this is anti-intellectual and anti-historical. The reality of it is that those are also just two exemplar texts under Common Core that really properly belong in a history curriculum or history standards. As Sandra said, English teachers are well-versed, and is why usually they go into teaching English, is they want to teach classic literature, poetry, and drama. And the problem with Common Core is that it ignores the now pile of evidence from Massachusetts, and we also know this from high-performing countries in the PISA exam, that the kids who tend to do better come from either states or countries that have a deep commitment to classic literature, poetry, and drama. I would just say one final thing, and it builds on a little bit with what Sid has said, is that when you exclude Huckleberry Finn, or you exclude Edith Wharton or Sherlock Holmes the way Common Core does, you're missing out on something deep and profound about human nature. This is where children learn through stories about love, through about drama, about tragedy. These are the things that are bind us together as human beings. And I think there's a very great danger with Common Core of trying to put a technical proficiency in math and science ahead of developing human beings. And I think there's lots of examples from the 20th century, from totalitarian regimes, how that is a very, very dangerous equation.
Okay, so this does not sound good. I have to tell you, it's very alarming to hear this. But one of the things that the proponents say with Common Core, especially English language arts, is this is going to get our kids to think critically. And I've heard you say just the opposite. So can you explain to parents why the proponents would say this teaches critical thinking, and why you're saying it really doesn't?
To claim that these standards will lead to critical thinking is a mystery to me, because there is nothing in any of the standards, so far as I can see, that would lead anyone to become a critical thinker. Critical thinking comes from, first of all, having a knowledge base in whatever area one is going to be doing any critical thinking in, and then knowing how to read between the lines of whatever is there, which means being able to draw upon your knowledge base, and being able to somehow put different pieces of information together, some of which may be there in different parts of the text, but some of which will be drawn upon. And it takes a long time to build that up, and you need a sequential curriculum. And that isn't part of Common Core. They're mainly skills, not content. There is virtually almost no literary historical knowledge that is required by Common Core. And in order by high school for that kind of literary historical knowledge to be to be drawn upon because it's been acquired, you need to make sure that through the grades, students have been exposed to the kind of works that have been of some kind of historical or cultural significance. But they're not there, because Common Core's standards are really not standards. They're simply skills. And skills, like find the main idea, can apply to The Three Little Pigs or to Moby Dick. You've got to have works chosen by a knowledgeable teacher that build on each other, which is what
the best of private schools have always done, including schools like Sidwell, where the president's children go, or, for example, the Brearley School, which I show the grade 6 curriculum in my last book that came out in 2012. And you can see
thought of what should be taught in reading in the beginning of the year, what would be the kind of ideas, not themes, but ideas that would come through the year, so that by the end of the year, they're able to read the Odyssey. These children are good readers, but there's something that's going to lead them to understand the Odyssey. It will be maybe Ovid's Metamorphoses in the early part of the year, Greek mythology, but background for understanding later works that may come in later centuries, even from earlier works. That's what we mean by cultural references or cultural connections. And there's absolutely none of that possible through Common Core standards. If it happens by groups of English teachers getting together in a school, it's happenstance, and it needs some direction and director to make sure that it happens.
Okay, you know, Sid, what do you do as an administrator, what do you do as a teacher if this is put on your plate?
Well, I would like to just say something else just for, tack on to this kind of thing. I think if you would ask parents what kind of people would they like their children to turn out to be, what kind of human beings would they like to be, I think you'll find that they will say, well, we want them to be good human beings, we want them to understand others, we want them to get along, we want them to be able to give themselves back to communities and so forth, and all those good things. You know, the only laboratory that we have to immerse kids in that sort of thing to develop is literature. That's the laboratory of human nature is in literature. And Common Core is decimating it. And parents really have to understand this, that this is the danger that I spoke of before. This is critical. This is so critical to the education and development of good human beings and good communities and people working together in a process that will be beneficial to society. We are destroying that with the Common Core because kids are not going to have this laboratory available to them at all. And that's very significant to me and very frightening to me.
Well, and you know, a lot of times, I mean, Jamie, I'm hearing from people that are saying, well, teachers love this, teachers support this, you know, administrators support this. And here we're hearing from a former teacher, an administrator with credentials that are, you know, an arm's length long, and he's saying no. And so how did you do it so differently in Massachusetts to get teachers to support this, to the transparency? How did it work there in what we're seeing here? What should we be doing?
Well, I think the stars really aligned in significant ways. And the key one was that Dr. Stotsky was really the prime mover and created real intellectual coherence to the standards in Massachusetts. But I think some credit is also due to the chair of the Board of Ed at the time, John Silber, who had been the president of Boston University, as well as the three co-authors of the Ed Reform Law in Massachusetts, Bill Weld, Mark Roosevelt, and Tom Birmingham. All of them were Ivy League educated men. They had experiences in either elite, private, or parochial schools. And I think what their wish really was with Ed Reform in Massachusetts was to take that high quality academic content, particularly things like literature, drama, and poetry, and make sure that that was more broadly available to public school students who for decades have been caught in sort of guardrail to guardrail on different kind of fads that had blown through education. So again, I think a lot of it had to do with the efforts and intellectual energy that Dr. Stotsky brought to the table. I'd just like to say two other things. So in the paper that we did with Dr. Stotsky and Tony Eslin, who's a professor of literature and a Dante scholar at Providence College, the authors of that paper, and Dr. Eslin in particular, said that the Common Core folks are people that really don't like poetry. And what do we know about the Odyssey and the Iliad? We know that these are are poems, first of all, and that they're the most important poems and stories in the history of Western civilization. To have people that are influencing and controlling the educational outlook of 45 million children who, in the opinion of an expert on Dante, doesn't like poetry is a very, very troubling development.
Absolutely. Go ahead.
Let me add to what Jamie was just saying. In Massachusetts, one of the keys to answer your question, how did we end up getting standards that could lead to a strong English curriculum, was that we drew on English teachers to help write the standards. This was not what Common Core did. It excluded high school English teachers. They were not present on the Standards Development Committee, they were not among the standards writers, and they were not on the Validation Committee. But we had high school English teachers on both the Standards Development Committee and the Assessment Development Committee to select the right kinds of passages. And good, experienced teachers who are known to have had strong academic demands over the years for their students know what works. They could select as examples for the standards. They could literally give a good example for each standard. You do not have in Common Core a good example for each standard, but that was part of what I wanted. If you write out a good standard, what's an example of a text that could address that standard? It's just an example. It's not required because we can't require works at the state level. But at least, what is the kind of text that another English teacher could use if she wanted to, and then understand what the standard wants? And so we had English teachers up and down the line also encouraging us to have appendices with recommended authors divided by educational level, which we also had. But that isn't, again, what Common Core did. It excluded the very high school teachers in math and in English who could have guided coherent and well-written standards.
Wow. We only have about a minute left. Can you give just a quick piece of advice, anybody, to parents that are listening to this? What should they be doing? Should they be reading to their kids more? Because, you know, the classics, making sure, I mean, what do they do?
I think parents have to be very active in this, and they've been encouraged not to be active in this. Yeah. And they have to storm the barricades, if they have to, in the interest of their own children, be advocates for their children, because it's their education that's at stake. We are living in an era now in American public education that's an era of coerciveness. And I'll also be very honest with them and say it lies. We are being told fabrications about this in order to keep this play of power play in gear and moving along.
Okay, well, we are at the end of the show. First of all, if you are watching and you've missed the prior shows, go back and watch them, because this is English Language Arts. We've done one on math, and then we did one on the Common Core in general. Go back and watch those too, because this will give you some insight. I want to thank my guests again for joining me, and please check out the website, sign a petition, and then join us for our next show. We're going to actually do another segment, and that's going to be on the Smarter Balance Test. You're not going to want to miss that one, so stay tuned.